Well, we're so happy that you chose GoldSeek.com Radio as a trusted investing and business news source. Today's special guest, Mr. John Embry from Sprott Asset Management. Well, John Embry, an industry expert in precious metals, researched gold sector for over 30 years, a portfolio manager since 1963, senior advisor at Sprott Asset Management, GoldSeek Radio's favorite. Welcome back, John Embry.
Well, it's great to be here as always, Chris.
Interesting article this week from Dr. Ron Paul, you know, another big supporter and friend of our show here, notes that voters in Switzerland are heading to the polls for a referendum on gold, and there's going to be a ballot to prohibit the Swiss National Bank from further gold sales. In other words, the everyday individual is starting to wake up and say, you know what, it's not a good idea if you take our sovereign wealth that our families have built up as a nation and, you know, loan it out to people and who knows where it goes and who owns what. Tell us why you think Dr. Paul might be onto something here, please.
Well, I think the referendum is maybe even wider than that. I think there's some suggestion that also included is the idea that they're going to repatriate what gold there is that's held outside the country that belongs to the Swiss, which again would put the cat amongst the pigeons because, I mean, we all know that any of this gold that has been farmed out to secondary custodians has probably been leased out and doesn't exist. So I'm very hopeful that the Swiss people are finally going to realize that their central bank has been doing them dirt in the gold space. I mean, one of the things about Switzerland, they were always very rigorous about this stuff. And suddenly, sort of as the gold wars heated up a few years ago, they sold a significant proportion of their gold. And there's some suggestion that the stuff that they still held has been leased. So I think this is a very positive development that they're going to let the public vote on this and have a say rather than the Swiss National Bank, which is just basically working for the international cartel.
You know, I think everyone should keep an eye on their activities, particularly when it comes to finance, economics. Quick anecdotes about the nation. You know, they've managed to stay out of the middle of a couple of really unsavory wars in the last century. We've learned over the years that the Swiss actually have a couple of interesting things. They like to stay out of foreign entanglements, which is interesting because that's what we used to do here in this continent as well. They actually have all the tunnels, the train tunnels and highways that enter or leave their nation. This may sound extreme, but are actually wired with explosives. China and Russia, the train tracks that go to and from China and Russia at the borders, they actually have different sized rails. So they have to change the trains actually over into completely different wheel sizes. And this, of course, is what they've learned over the years, that, you know, you have to be a little wary from time to time with what's going on with commerce and wealth leaving and entering one's nation.
But no, I think that one of the things that people should think something about are the smaller communities, Switzerland, Norway, Uruguay. They're probably running the most successful countries today. And this international movement to make things bigger and integrate things, I think, is breaking down. I have great respect for the Swiss, and I think what we're going to see here in the next couple of days is this Scottish election to see whether they will leave the UK. The UK is petrified this is going to happen because I think this is going to seriously impact the city of London. And it's going to be fascinating to see whether they can coerce the Scottish into sort of staying in the Union. If I were a Scot, I would leave.
You know, I just haven't done my due diligence. You know, this would be like a portion of Canada or the United States, maybe New England and the United States saying, you know, we've been waiting for this for about 1,000 years or at least 500 years, and it's time to say our goodbyes. I mean, what an interesting thing. And one wonders about the economic ramifications for both countries. Do you have any comments?
The economic ramifications are serious. The Scots are only, I think, 6 million people, but they have about a third of the landmass. But more importantly, they have an oil off the coast of Aberdeen and what have you. This would be a huge blow to England, huge blow.
Well, that's food for cogitation. I wonder if we might also address some other geopolitical issues that we've seen. And I know that you've been monitoring the temporary ceasefire between Russia and Ukraine. Almost every one of our guests has had their own unique perspective on the potential that could come from this situation, that it might even be perhaps the spark of something larger and another good reason to have some portfolio insurance, i.e. sound money in one's portfolio. Although we have a temporary ceasefire, at least as of last week, think of the strategic significance here. We have Ukraine areas known as one of the breadbaskets of all of Europe, or at least Eurasia. And then you also have the natural gas and the pipelines running from Russia through there. And there's even the electrical lines that give power to much of Europe other than France. Can you tell us what your thoughts here on the significance?
I just read a long piece out of all publications, Foreign Affairs. It was written by a U.S. professor in the States. And he had the most even-handed view on this. I mean, clearly, the U.S. and NATO have been pursuing this to the extent that they've really alienated Russia. Like, Russia is being demonized, and I don't think they're the real problem here. I think the problem lies more with the West. Russia is attempting to protect its territorial integrity. And as a result, I think they're almost being lured into a fight, but Putin's too smart. He's not going to get into a fight. All of this geopolitical stuff that's going on, I find extremely unsettling because it's coming against the backdrop of extreme difficulty in both the financial and the economic spheres.
Right.
You begin to wonder whether that's the reason it's being done, is sort of to sort of deflect attention from this, from these problems in the real world.
Oh, the Hegelian dialectic at work. Problem, reaction, solution.
Yeah, exactly. It troubles me because, you know, we can't have a third world war. I mean, that this is just out of the question because there's just too much nuclear armament in the world.
You're looking at the chessboard. You're three or four moves ahead of the mainline media. It's that perspective that we really need as investors, isn't it? Nowadays, it's just not enough to read the headlines, and we need the minutiae in order to prepare. If we are looking at another Archduke Ferdinand-style moment, Lusitania, are you implying here that perhaps it could be Ukraine?
Well, it could be. I would prefer not to believe that. I think that there's just too many armaments in the world today. We can't let it come to that.
Exactly, because, you know, as famous physicists said, the Fourth World War would be fought most likely with sticks and stones.
Oh, that was the great line of Einstein's, and it's absolutely true.
You know, we also have incredible U.S. dollar strength. But, you know, in the final analysis, I think if you look at the big technical picture, the dollar has been stuck in a trading range for going on 4 years. Every time it reaches the top of that range, it just seems to fall right back down. But it certainly has implications for the metals. Any thoughts?
I mean, obviously the dollar is the antithesis of gold and silver. And the people in the United States, the authorities, are desperate to keep the dollar sort of elevated. They're lying about the economic reality, and I think they're interfering with markets to sort of make things look better than they are. And as a result, gold and silver have been sort of marginalized. And what they've created is an incredible buying opportunity in both metals.
Another key component in this precious metal story, we see the Federal Reserve last week still holding rates steady while the ECB has taken even further steps towards liquidity, a dovish stance there by taking rates even further negative. This is something I don't think we've ever seen before, have we? I mean, have we seen the central banks actually take their benchmark lending rates into negative territory?
Well, I think it tells you, Chris, exactly how serious this problem is. I mean, basically, there's infinitely too much debt in the world. There's massive numbers of derivatives. And the combination of both these things are going to bring the banking system down if interest rates were to rise. So they're going to do everything to try to prevent that.
Another takeaway point, I mean, we have China and India together consuming nearly 3/4 of the total gold output each year, over 1,000 metric tons with China and not too far from that with India as well. This is quite an interesting situation, because if just two countries alone are purchasing most of the world's output, what happens when the rest of the industrialized world? What about the BRIC nation? We have Brazil, and we also have Russia, which has a strong interest in the yellow metal, plus South Africa, which is a major producer. That's just four or five nations, and the rest of the world is likely to increase demand for gold as inflation becomes more evident. Wouldn't you agree?
This is what's going to break the whole gold market wide open, Chris. I mean, right now, the buyers are just hanging in the weeds and buying it after the paper market drives the price lower. At some point, this whole thing's going to change. There's going to be an enormous demand for physical gold. And that's when the physical market takes over. And as a result, the price is going to go berserk. What we're debating isn't whether it's going to happen. It's when it's going to happen.
That's still the wild card, because they have their bazookas, if you will, their central banking bazookas pointed right at the gold market, because they know, as you say, the antithesis. It is anathema.
It's their worst nightmare. And I mean, if the gold and silver market really traded where they should be trading, interest rates in the world would rise by several hundred basis points, the debt load would collapse, the derivative bomb would be set off, and the world would be totally different.
Would you like to share any contact information or let folks know more about Sprott Asset Management?
Come to www.sprott.com, and we got lots of interesting stuff on the website.
Very good. Mr. Embry, we appreciate your help, and thanks so much.
My pleasure all the time, Chris.